social and political movement. So here I am sharing my PowerPoint presentation. We will go through it. So today we are going to learn about the social and political movement in detail about it. So here I am sharing my screen. You can see here, this is a local newspaper advertisement. I am going to read aloud. Movement against child marriage has been successful to a great extent, and the extent of child marriage have reduced by 50%. The worker in this movement worked very consciously. Worker from the movement against dowry also helped them. Now there is a need to start a drive against malnutrition, because poverty and malnutrition are two important problems to be taken on priority basis. This is a news published in a local newspaper, but this news has a 2-3 news in a same article. So we have to bifurcate that. So I have one question for all of you. In the above newspaper item, different movements are included. Can you explain the meaning? The second one, this news deals with different subjects. Are movements related to only one issue? If different movements cooperate with each other, will they be more effective? So these are my questions for all of you. I think you people have to raise your hand if you could answer the questions. We go forward. Charushila ma'am.
Students, raise your hands.
First
students,
question.
Students, raise your hands for answering.
Hello.
Yes, Sonu. Sonu, you can ask your doubt. Sorry,
In the above newspaper item, different movements are included. Can you explain their meaning? Or this news deals with different subject. Are movements related to only one issue? Do you have any idea? Anybody, please. The class must be interactive one. Otherwise, it is very hard to learn history. You people have to talk. Three people are there who are raising their hands. Charushila ma'am. Is there anybody, please? Okay. This newspaper has 2-3 different news included. This is a newspaper and 2-3 news are included in this. The first one is, movement against child marriage has been successfully to a great extent, and the extent of child marriage has reduced up to 50%. The second news is, the worker in this movement worked very consciously. Worker from the movement against dowry also helped them. Now there is a need to start a drive against malnutrition, because poverty and malnutrition are two important problems to be taken on priority basis. So the worker problem is ultimately connected with poverty, and ultimately poverty is connected with malnutrition. So there are 2-3 different news. But if one can raise their voice against such issues collectively, and then it could be the movement. So the 2-3 questions are there. It is related to each other. I'm going to move on next slide. In the previous chapter, we got information about the national and regional party. So why we are going to see in previous chapter, why we are going to just go back in the previous chapter? Because the social and political movements are definitely a concern with political parties. So in the previous chapter, we got information about the national and regional parties. Political parties compete for political power. So I think in the last period, the teacher is focused on this political power, because each and every party always contest the election to get into the power. So why they need to get into the power? Because only political party is contesting election to get into the power, and whatever the issues came before them from the society, so they can resolve that problems by having the power. That's why every political party is competing for the political power. The third one is they win election and try to resolve the problem of the common people. As I said, comprehensive perspective of political parties. As we discussed in our first slide about the TET news, so whenever people facing so many issues in the society in a different strata at that time, the political party has to be focused on that particular issues. So any political party never had any particular subject with them. They are having number of subject with them and they are dealing with it. So that's why every political party is having a comprehensive perspective, not at the local level, as well as they have to keep into that problem accordingly by the state, accordingly by the national level also. Political parties take into consideration all matters from national perspective and take decision. So any political party, when they are taking any decision, they have to take into consideration that particular issue up to national level. The sixth one is political parties always adopt policies for the interest of all. So all the political parties are having their policies keep into consideration this all farmer, labor, businessman, women, youth and senior citizen. Why the movement? So from here we are starting our this chapter. Why the movement? All the people in the society cannot participate in political parties and contribute to social welfare. So what happened? There are number of political parties are there, national parties, regional parties, but not everyone could be participate in particular parties and contribute to the social welfare. So in such case, people are trying to do some welfare things for the society. At that time, they collectively come together on particular aspect and trying to do something good work for the social welfare. So such peoples are coming together on the particular issues, and that issues could be the movement. So what kind of issues would be that? We'll see further. People focus on a particular issue and pursue it. So whenever people are having any kind of problem, they want to pursue their matter to the government. At that time, they are collectively come together, found any kind of organization. Otherwise, they come together, discuss together, and come to the conclusion and pursue their matter to the government or the political parties. They organize people and try to pursue their pressurize the government to resolve their issues. So whenever people are having any issues, they organize the people, come together, discuss together and pursue their matter to the government and try to pressurize the government to resolve their issues. The fourth one is they build public opinion about it and thereby put a pressure on political parties and the government. So what happened, we know very well in the society, whenever people having any problem, they come together, but they cannot raise their voice. They need a kind of organization to raise their voice at that time. So many NGOs, so many social organizations are there who are come forward and meet to that particular peoples who are having any problems, and they are organize them in a particular group. And then only built their pressure upon that political parties, whoever leading the government in that particular state or in the central government. So this is the main purpose of the movement, to pressurize the government or political parties. The fifth one is such type of organization activity is called a movement. Means whenever people facing problem, they came together, they organized together, they are having the same interest, they approach to particular organization, when organization attached with them, then they raise their voice and they put pressure upon the political parties and the government. So such organizations are called a movement. The next one, why movement? Organized activity is essence of any movement. Whenever any movement is there, the activity must be organized. Otherwise, that movement cannot be successful. Why? Because when it is organized one, definitely there should be a plan. How to approach to the particular party, how to approach to the particular leader, how to approach to the government, with how many people they have to pressurize the government. When group of people are came together, they organize together, then only they can pressurize the government. They can put their issue before the government. That's why the activity of the movement must be organized. The seventh one, importance of the such movement in democracy. So in democracy, when, as we know very well, we are aware about it, the peoples are facing so many problems in the society, but each and every problem cannot be conveyed to the government by any organization or any group of the people. So whenever number of peoples are facing the same problem, they collectively come together for their own interest at that time. Whenever any organization come to know that situation and they attach with them, then only the movement is get organized. And in such case only, that such movement will affect the democracy. So that is the importance of such movement in the democracy. Different social issues discussed under such movement. So ultimately, government has to pay attention towards such issues and make a policies accordingly. As I said earlier, whenever people come together, organize together, pursue their issues before the government, pressurize the government at that time, whoever they are in the power of that particular state, the particular party, they have to pay attention toward the issues of such movement. Whatever the issues are there at that time, they have to resolve the issues. They have to pay attention, because group of people, the group of people came together, organized together, and they're protesting the government against any policies or any issues. So in such case, government has to pay attention towards such issues and make policies accordingly, whatever the problems are there of that particular group. The ninth one is some movement aim at opposing a particular decision or policy of the government. Sometimes government making different kind of policies for the welfare of the society. But in such case, number of time, that particular policies is not suitable for that particular group of the society. At that time, peoples are opposing that particular policy. So how they are opposing? So they are coming together, they are organizing together, they are having the movements, and this way they can pressurize the government or opposing that particular policy of the government. The right to protest is an important right in the democracy. This is the very important right in the hand of common people, which has been awarded by our Indian Constitution to the individual. That is, the right to protest is an important right in the democracy. Though it is an important right in the hand of individual, but very sensibly one has to be used this right of protest. Because though the government making any policies, definitely all the policies are not suitable for the all people of the society, all kind of the people of the society. Suppose government make any policy and that policy could not be suitable for the farmer, sometime it could not be suitable for the worker, sometime it could not be suitable for the students, sometime it could not be suitable for the senior citizens, sometime it could not be suitable for the businessmen. So in such case, whoever don't suit that particular provision made by the government, the people come together because their interest is a common one. So they organize together and they try to protest. That's why though the Indian Constitution given that right to protest to the individual, they have to use that right to protest very sensibly. What is a movement? A movement is a collective action. As I said earlier, movement is a collective action. It means people have to come together with particular interests. They have to organize together. They have to protest the things. they have to pursue their issue to the government or to the particular party. That's why movement is a collective action. Active participation is expected in the movement. Whenever any movement is there, whoever joining that movement, whoever the group of the peoples are joining the movement, they has to be active. Otherwise, that movement cannot be lead successfully. So why the active participant is needed in the movement? Because if suppose we said the movement, that means there is something happened towards the society. Means the people are facing some kind of problem. And they have to convey their problem to the government or the particular party. So at that time, they have to raise their voice. That means sometimes they have to shout. Sometimes they have to show some votes. Sometimes they have to show, write some letters. They have to sometimes sign over that particular letter. So this way, the different ways of movements are there. So that's why the active participation is very much essential for any movement. The third one is a movement can be formed when people come together in the interest of particular issue. As I said earlier, movement can be formed when only when people are having the same interest on particular issue. The issue could be the different. We will discuss further what kind of issue would be there and how would be faced. So the issue could be different, but people have to be come together and with particular interest. Fourth one is a movement has a particular social objective or a focus problem. For example, movement against corruption aims at ending corruption. There is an example, as I said, a movement has a particular social objective or a focus problem. For example, movement against corruption aim at ending corruption. There is an example of Sri Anna Hazare ji, who is from Maharashtra. Student may know very well him. So I have one video of Anna Hazare ji who protested in 2011 at Ram Lila Maidan in Delhi against the corruption. So I'm going to play that video. Please, student, watch it carefully.
भारत माता की भारत.
So this is the video of Anna Hazare ji who collectively collect so many people. They organize together and they protest against the corruption at central level, at the India level, at country level. And that Anna Hazare ji is belong to Maharashtra. He is from Ahmednagar. Okay, I'm not going in detail. Just see the clip.
माता की वंदे वंदे इंकलाब इंकलाब धन्यवाद.
So this is the clip and here she is a Kiran Bedi. She is a IPS officer who joined with Anna Hazare ji in that particular movement as well. He is also the leader of that Aam Aadmi Party, who is leading that government in Delhi right now as well.
Sabhi bhai aur behno, 1942 mein.
Again, I'm stopping here. Here is Manish Sisodia. He is the deputy chief minister of Delhi government. These people came together. Again, Arvind Kejriwal is there. He is in the in further clip. So the people come together, they organize and they protest against the corruption at India level. And then again, they establish their own party. In further clip, it is there, but I'm just focusing. This he is Manish Sisodia.
हमारे देश में एक क्रांति हुई थी और उसके उस क्रांति के कारण गोरा अंग्रेज इस देश से चला गया. अंग्रेज चला गया लेकिन भ्रष्टाचार खत्म नहीं हुआ, गुंडागर्दी खत्म नहीं हुई, लूट खत्म नहीं हुई. इसलिए आजादी की दूसरी लड़ाई की शुरुआत हो गई, अभी यह दूसरी क्रांति की शुरुआत है। और देश के सभी लोगों ने, मेरे भाई, मेरे बहन, मेरे युवा युवती, स्कूल के छात्र, इन सब ने ये जो मशाल जलाई है, इस मशाल को कभी भी बुझने नहीं देना, कभी बुझने नहीं देना। चाहे अन्न हजारे रहे न रहे, लेकिन मशाल जलते रहेगी, एक क्रांति की मशाल जलते रहेंगी। अभी एक लोकपाल नहीं,
सो ही इज द अन्ना हजारे हु प्रोटेस्ट अगेंस्ट करप्शन at India level, and then the whoever the people joined with him, they established their own party. They established their own party, and right now they are ruling in Delhi government. Right now they are ruling in Delhi government, and Manish Sisodia, to whom I just figured out there, he was the deputy chief minister of that Delhi government. The fifth one is movement have leadership. Leadership keep the movement active. Example, Arvind Kejriwal, who is the right now chief minister of Delhi government. He lead that corruption movement in Delhi at Ram Leela Maidan. Then again, they establish their own party, and right now they are ruling in Delhi government. So how the social cause come to political cause? So that's why social and political movements are collaborate with each other, and it is beneficial for the welfare of the society. The next one is, what is a movement? Object of the movement, program of action, strategy of agitation are decided by its leader. Wait for Charushila ma'am. Charushila ma'am. Charushila ma'am. Okay, so we are here. So then, what is a movement? Object of the movement, program of the action, strategy of agitation are decided by its leader. A strong leadership makes movement effective. If the leader is not strong one, the movement cannot be lead. To lead any movement, the leader must be effective. He must be a strong. He must be have the knowledge of that particular issue. Then only that particular movement could be successful. That's why the strong leadership needed for any movement. Then movement have organization. Without organization, any movement can't lead properly. As I said earlier, whenever any movement is there, that movement must be organized one. Then only it lead properly and it could successful. The ninth one, farmer movement in Maharashtra, leader Sharad Anand Rao Joshi, leader Raju Shetty. So why I am giving this name, farmer movement in Maharashtra? So leader Sharad Anand Rao Joshi, he is the leader who is a strong leader of that farmer movement in Maharashtra. After Sharad Anand Rao Joshi, Raju Shetty is there, who is right now the MP of our India Indian Parliament right now. He is from Kolhapur. Raju Shetty, he is leading the farmer movement in Maharashtra very nicely. Then again, movement require public support. People should feel connected to the issue that is undertaken by the movement. So any movement, it needed support of the public. When people came together in a group, when number of people came together in a group, they connected to the particular organization, so then only that movement could be the successful. That's why public support very much essential for any movement. So here is the video where I am going to play of the movement. Charushila ma'am.
Yes. Yes, sir.
My battery is
social movements are instrumental to changing the path of society. When a group of people comes together with a shared idea, they can create lasting effects by encouraging change in their society or by resisting it, both of which will shape the future.
Hello.
Yes.
Electricity is not there at my place, so my battery of laptop is going to drain.
Okay.
Already I am joined from my mobile phone.
Okay, no problem, sir.
So you can make me co-host on mobile phone if suppose I am going to drop here.
Okay, no problem, sir.
Future of their society. But a social movement is not...
Please watch this video very much carefully. In this video, you can come to know what is movement, what is social movement, what is political movement, and how it is going to start.
Not just a group of people with an idea. If that were the case, every little group with a novel idea would be starting a social movement. No, social movements need organization, leadership, and resources if they ever hope to gain momentum and make an impact. There are different types of social movements depending on their goal. Activist movements are focused on changing some aspect of society, while regressive or reactionary movements are actively trying to resist change. So you can generally see how a social movement will form. You get a group with a strong shared idea that has the resources and leadership to survive, and they can make a difference in one way or another. Specifically, though, it is not well defined. There are several theories as to how and why social movements form. One of these is called mass society theory. Early in the study of social movements, people were skeptical of the motivations of those involved in social movements. They were seen as dysfunctional, irrational, and dangerous, and that people would only join because a social movement provided a sense of community and refuge from the meaninglessness of life on one's own. This viewpoint was strong during the 20th century, the time of Nazism, Fascism, and Stalinism, which were social movements that resulted in the destruction of millions of lives. But this theory did not persist through the century. By the 60s, scholars took a more open look at social movements, especially after the civil rights movement, which certainly did not arise simply to satisfy a psychological need for involvement. More recently, a few main theories have been developed. One is the relative deprivation theory, which focuses on the actions of groups who are oppressed or deprived of rights that other people in their society enjoy. So, if you look at the civil rights movement from this viewpoint, it is obviously a response to the inequality and oppression experienced by people of color in the U.S. But what is interesting about social movements is that it isn't always the people who are the worst off who join up. More important is how people perceive their situation. Someone just scraping by can be happy as a clam because they made their dream of owning their own little corner bistro into a reality. And then a person making $100,000 a year is frustrated because they don't feel like they are respected by their company. So what you have to look at is the relative deprivation, the feeling of a discrepancy between legitimate expectations and the reality of the present. But that's not enough on its own. People must feel like they deserve better, and they must think that they cannot be helped by conventional means. According to relative deprivation theory, those three things are necessary for a social movement to form: a relative deprivation, a feeling of deserving better, and a belief that conventional methods are useless to help. But there are criticisms to this theory. Even people who don't feel deprived will choose to join a social movement. They join because they want to address a perceived injustice that they may not even suffer from themselves. It can be too risky for the most oppressed people to join a social movement because they may not have the resources to participate. They cannot take time off work to promote the idea. Even so, there are exceptions, as always. Under Cesar Chavez, migrant farm workers united to gain rights and job security. Another issue with the relative deprivation theory is that sometimes, even when all three factors are present, no social movement is created. Okay, so it has some problems, but it's a start at least. Another theory, resource mobilization theory, looks at the social movements from a different angle. Instead of looking at the deprivation of the people, the resource mobilization approach focuses on the factors that help or hinder a social movement, you know, practical constraints like access to resources. Even the seemingly simple act of gathering together a group of people with a shared idea is not allowed everywhere. It takes more than an idea to start a social movement. You need money, materials, political influence, access to media. More than that, a social movement needs a strong organizational base to recruit members and then to unite them on a single idea. A good, charismatic figure is necessary to lead the group and focus the thoughts of members and the oppressed on the objective, to convince them to organize. Again, looking at the civil rights movement, Martin Luther King Jr. stood as a beacon to the people of color who were oppressed. He knew how to speak to a crowd and unite them in a single idea, and how to gain the support he needed for the social movement to succeed. Then you have the rational choice theory, which proposes that people compare pros and cons of different courses of action, and choose the one that they think is best for themselves. The choices and actions of individuals who are trying to do the best for themselves shape the pattern of behavior in society. But there are a lot of assumptions for rational choice theory to work. You have to assume that all actions can be listed in order of preference, and that all preferences are transient. That means that, let's say, I like apples better than pears, and I like pears better than bananas. If that's transient, then that means I have to like apples better than bananas. It also assumes that a person has full knowledge of what will happen as a result of an action, and that a person has a cognitive ability to weigh different actions. These are a lot of assumptions, which are rarely all true. Social movements can even affect people not actively involved in them. Social movements can cause collective behavior like panics, where widespread unreasoning fear causes people to act hastily, and crazes, which are like fads, where something is incredibly popular for a short period of time, like the latest craze in music or dieting. This past year, the anti-vaccine movement has created a panic that has resulted in outbreaks of diseases that were once eradicated from the developed world. Now that we have a couple movements to toss around, it might be interesting to look at what happens to a social movement from beginning to either success or failure in the end. In the beginning, the universe was created. This has made a lot of people very angry and has been widely regarded as a bad move. Wait a minute. Sorry, that's the wrong story. Social movements, right. Those begin with a few ideas shared by a few. Then you have the incipient stage, when the public begins to take notice of a situation that they consider to be a problem. At this point, people begin to organize, to coalesce into an organized group and raise up a general stink. A social movement's greatest achievement will be to either succeed in changing its host society, or else it will have to adapt. What is interesting about social movements is that, in the end, they become a part of the bureaucracy they were trying to change. A successful social movement eventually gets absorbed into the existing institutions when it has achieved its desired changes. Our entire culture and society is formed from past social movements, both those that have succeeded and those that have failed. Even in failure, social movements leave a mark on their society. The social movement Martin Luther began against the Catholic Church resulted in Protestantism. His namesake, Martin Luther King Jr., fronted a social movement against segregation leading to the Civil Rights Movement. Even Nazism left its lasting mark on world politics. In their time, each of these social movements seemed radical, far-fetched, extreme. Now, we accept Protestantism as a founded religion, and we don't think twice about the right every person has to freedom and equality. I wonder what social movements of today will become accepted thought in the future. So, in the end, the social movement eventually declines. If it succeeded, it has been incorporated into the dominant culture. If it failed, it isn't active anymore, but you can still see the marks left on society by its passing.
So this is the movement, how it is lived, how it becomes social movement, then how it is converted social event movement from social movement to political movement. Okay, we'll go further. So generally, the movement are devoted to one particular issue, but have an ideology behind them. For example, movement against child marriage, dowry, believe in values of democracy, woman empowerment and social equality. Sometimes some movement gradually get transformed into political parties. So again, here is the example of farmer movement in Maharashtra. So which one is right now led by Raju Shetty, who is the Minister of Parliament. Their movement is converted into party. That political party is right now known as a Swabhimani Shetkari Sangatna. Now it is established farmer political party. As I discussed earlier, the anti-corruption movement, which one is led by Anna Hazare ji along with Arvind Kejriwal ji. their party, before party, that is organization, who are opposing the government with their policies, and they come together on the basis of anti-corruption movement, and they form their own party. Their party is right now known as a Aam Aadmi Party, whose leader is Arvind Kejriwal. At present, he is the Chief Minister of Delhi government. Here is the video, but I'm not going to play that video. You can the video is already present in Topper app. You can go through Topper app and watch the video. So can you tell me which movement in India are actively working for rehabilitation of the displaced and to secure their livelihood? The second one, which movement in India led to filling of public interest litigation and the judiciary has to give a decision regarding PIL? Name the movement started by Mahatma Gandhi. Name the movement started by Mahatma Phule. Name the movement started by Sant Gadge Maharaj. The sixth one is, name the movement started by Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. These are veteran leaders of India, Mahatma Phule, Mahatma Gandhi, Sant Gadge Maharaj, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Definitely all of you are very well known about their movements. So I'm expecting from all of you, you people have to give me answer about this question number 3, 4, 5 and 6. Charushila ma'am. Charushila ma'am.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to ask the questions to the students. Please ask them to raise their hands.
Students, sir is going to ask some questions. We have, I think, 5 to 7 minutes now.
Those
who want to answer can raise your hands.
You can take the snap. Student, please take the snap of the screen. You have to write the answer.
Take the screenshot. Whatever sir is displaying, take the screenshot.
Please. These all questions are mentioned in our textbook also. I just organized here.
Yes, Rupesh.
Yes, ma'am.
You want
third
to answer
question, it? Name the
Yes, Rupesh, yes, better. Yes. Go ahead.
Name the movement started in started by Mahatma Gandhi. Champaran movement, Kheda movement, Khalifat movement, non-corporation movement.
Yes, very good.
Very good, beta.
Very good, beta. Who you is the next one? Name the movement started by Mahatma Phule. Rupesh has just given the answer of question number 3. Name the movement started by Mahatma Phule.
Raise your hand. Students, again and again I am telling, with your name I should see your school name. Who is this, Habib? Write your name properly. Alfie, write your name properly with school name. Ayan Khan, Ayush Prajapati, do you want me to remove you all children? Sinega Shetty, Himesh, I don't know these students, which school they are. We have to maintain our attendance. Mani, no, she has mentioned the name.
Okay, anybody is there who is going to answer me? Name the movement started by Mahatma Phule.
Children, raise your hands for answering. Again, Rupesh.
Okay, Rupesh, go ahead.
Satya Shodak Samaj.
Very good. Mahatma Phule ji. Okay. Again.
Suchita.
Very good, Rupesh.
Suchita from Govindnagar, it seems.
Yes, Suchita.
By mistake, these children are raising their hands sometimes.
Okay, no problem. So again, I'm going to tell in detail about Sant Gadge Maharaj. Okay, Muskan Gupta. Muskan, please.
Muskan, you want to answer?
Right now in Maharashtra, the Maharashtra government is running a our big mission on the name of Sant Gadge Maharaj right now. That is known as a Gram Swachhata Abhiyan, Sant Gadge Maharaj Gram Swachhata Abhiyan. Renu, Renu Vishwakarma.
Renu, you can answer. Unmute yourself, beta, and answer. Unmute yourself, beta. Renu, you have raised your hand. Unmute yourself and answer.
Mahatma Gandhi Independence Movement.
Okay.
Beta, you are from which school? We are not able to see your school name.
I was written.
We are not able to see in the display. You can write it as Renu V and your school name so that it will be visible for us. Okay?
Yes, teacher, yes.
Yeah, okay. Mute yourself. Anyone else?
Okay, who is going to tell me the name of movement started by Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, who contributed a lot for our country? Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar.
Tripti Rajbhar.
Okay, Tripti Rajbhar, Varshanagar. Yes,
teacher. You want to answer?
Yes.
Yes.
Dalit Buddhist movement started by Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar.
Very good.
Very good, beta.
Very
good. Mute yourself. Riya Dubey. Riya Dubey, which school you are, beta? Riya Dubey.
Govindnagar MPS Secondary School.
Beta, very good, but write your name along with your school name. Do you find it difficult to rename? Is it difficult to rename? Yes, beta.
Is it difficult to rename?
आपको रीनेम करना डिफिकल्ट लग रहा है बेटा?
नहीं.
हाँ तो रीनेम करो, अपना स्कूल का नाम नहीं मालूम पड़ता ना.
हाँ वेट.
ओके यस, नाउ यू आंसर. आंसर बेटा.
द मूवमेंट हैज सॉर्ट टू बी अ सोशली एंड पॉलिटिकली एंगेज फॉर्म ऑफ बुद्धिज्म.
ओके वेरी गुड.
Was launched in 1956 by Ambedkar when nearly half a million Dalits, formerly untouchables, joined him and converted to Navayana Buddhism.
Okay, very good. Is there anybody else who is going to give the answer of these questions?
Riya, mute yourself, beta. Anyone else who wants to answer? Anyone else who wants to answer or having any doubts? Again, Rupesh.
Yes, no, Rupesh.
Gayu from Worli Seaface.
Miss, what is meant by rehabilitation?
Rehabilitation.
Yes, yes.
Where you heard better that word? Rehabilitation.
First question, which movement in India are
actively working for rehabilitation of the displaced,
yes,
and to secure their livelihood? So I'm asking question.
Yeah,
you have
but
to answer me.
No,
rehabilitation. Rehabilitation means the people are affected. They need to be get out from that particular place. They have to rehabilitate. They are displaced. They don't have a place. They have to be placed somewhere. That is rehabilitation.
They are shifted from the place where they are. That is called as rehabilitation. They are shifted to another places.
They are residing somewhere. They are residing somewhere, but due to any project, due to any issue, they has been shifted from their place. They have to be rehabilitated. That is rehabilitation.
Understood?
Yes.
You understood?
Yes.
Answer then.
Okay. Charushila ma'am.
Yes.
Okay, yes, student. In the next period, we will see all the answer of these questions in detail, and we go further. Okay.
Till then, students, you can find out these answers. Sir is going to discuss with you in the next lecture. You have time for it. You can find out the answers. Any doubts, you can get it cleared in the next lecture. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, students, all of you, for listening patiently.
Thank you, sir. Students,
I'm going to stop my screen
with me. Be continued with me. Within 10 minutes, we'll have our next lecture. That is science lecture by Shabana ma'am. So refresh yourself again by drinking water, eating something, and stay connected.